By the end of this video, you'll have all the tools you need to create cool particle effects for your Pygame projects. With some creativity, you can even achieve something like this. Or this. Or this. Or this. So on. We'll use classes and objects in this video, so if you're not familiar with the concept already, you can watch this tutorial and then get back to this one. In this project, we'll use three different files. The first one is the main.py. This will be the entry point of the library. Then we have a constants.py containing the window dimensions. Then let's prepare the last one too, particles.py. If we get back to the main.py, we can import Pygame. If it's not already installed onto your system or virtual environment, you can open the terminal and type pip install pygame ce, or simply pygame if you don't want the community edition. Now let's create the simplest functional Pygame window. We're gonna import the dimensions from the constants module. Then we create a display surface with these dimensions that will be the window. Don't forget the parentheses, as this method accepts a list of two integers. Then we can instantiate a clock object that we can use to update the window. Let's create a function that will serve as the main loop of the project. We put the whole thing into a while loop. Then we check the events and turn off the app if we close the window. Then we update the clock and fill the window with black color. Instead of RGB values, you can also use some built-in string values. You'll see soon that it works with both. We finish the loop with updating the display. Lastly, if this file is called directly and not used through an import, we initialize Pygame and run the application. That's it. We have a responsive window now. As I said, the background color works with string parameters as well. Now let's create those particles. We import Pygame again to use the sprite class and create subclasses of it. This built-in sprite class is powerful when it comes to displaying and updating sprites collectively. In the init method, I'll call the parent class init and we'll pass only one argument. That will be the group that we add the particle sprite object to. We'll get back to this. Now, the moving particle will have a position, a color, a direction, and some speed. For displaying, we create an image attribute. The naming is important, as the group will look for this specific attribute. So, this image will be the surface object with the dimensions 4x4. Let's convert the surface to optimize it. I'll also set the color key to be black, this way all the black pixels will be transparent. Then we'll draw a circle onto the surface with a given color centered around the 2x2 coordinate with a radius of 2. Then let's make a rectangle from this image centered at the position given above. We'll use this part multiple times, so we can also create a method out of it to keep the code dry. What we can also do is leaving type hints so we know what kind of arguments we deal with. The group will be a group object. The position is a list of two elements. The color is a string. The direction is Pygame's two-dimensional vector. And the speed is an integer. The coordinates are also integers. Let's go back and see what we created. First, we import the particle class from the particles module. And now we create the group object that I mentioned. It will make sense in a moment. Let's expand the event handling, so if we press a mouse button, we create a particle object. But since we need to pass position, color and stuff, we can define them before. The position will be the coordinates of the mouse that we get this way. To randomize the particles, we use the built-in random module. The choice will choose an element from the list we give to it. Then, the direction will be a two-dimensional vector. To make this random too, let's import uniform from random. This will give us a random float between the numbers we pass. On the x, -1 is left, 1 is right, on the y, -1 is up, and 1 is down. We should also normalize the vector to avoid its absolute being greater than 1. The last thing is the speed, that should be a random integer between these numbers. Now let's create a particle object with these. If we run the code and I click, nothing happens. That's because we added a new particle to the particle group, but we do nothing else with it. To see it, we need to draw the sprites in the group to the screen. I know you can't see my mouse, but if I click at random positions, particles start to appear. Great! Now let's move them. It's time to add a move method to the particles class. In this method, we update the position attribute of the objects. The value we add takes into account the direction and speed of the particle. Now we should refresh the center of the rectangle with this new position. But there's one thing we need to add, so the movement will be independent of the frame rate. If you don't do this, the app will be visually faster on better computers and slower on older ones. But we want to keep the dynamics of our games constant, right? Just think about it. If your computer is able to handle 60 iterations per second, then your game will be 60 FPS. Each iteration your character moves one to the right. If you have a slower PC that can run 20 iterations per second, the FPS will be 20 and your character moves 20 units to the right in 1 sec. This is not good. To avoid this, we should scale the movement in the game with the time passed between frames. And that is what clock.tick gives us in seconds. Let's use milliseconds now. And let me know if you want a complete tutorial about frame rate independency. I'll see what I can do. So, let's use this delta time now. Another useful thing about groups is that if our sprite has an update method, the group will also handle this and we don't need to call it one by one for each sprite. So now we can call the update method of our particle group. And let's see what we did. We see flying particles. This is great. One more step and we have a complete light show going. And that is to put this into a for loop. Ta-da! To make our code better, we can put this part into a function. Works fine. Although what you can notice is that the FPS drops after a while. Of course, that's why we need to remove the sprites that are not on the screen anymore. Let's create a checkpause method and within that, a huge if condition. To work with dimensions, we should import them into this module. So if the x-coordinate of the particle is less than minus 50 or greater than the screen width plus 50, same for y values, we destroy it with the conventionally named kill method. We add this to the update method and let's check it. Looks fine to me. In case you don't believe me, let me print the number of particles to the console. As you can see, it drops down. What are the chances of finishing with 404? Nice. Our next step is to create a fading effect for the particles. For this, we should create a fade method that accepts delta time just like the move method. And we also need the alpha and fade speed attributes. Again, just like with the move method, we modify the alpha with the product of speed and delta time. In the same place, we can set the transparency of the image to this new value. Let's check it. It looks fine, but be aware. Let me show you the number of sprites while lowering their speed so they don't reach the border so fast. See? Those sprites are still there, costing us computational resources. To address this, we should remove them once their transparency reaches zero. That's pretty simple. Don't forget to add this to the update method. Now we're all set. Great job. Two more particle types, but those are similar. In fact, they will inherit from the particle class itself. Let's create now the exploding particle class. We can just copy-paste the init arguments. But since the particle parent class will use all of them, we should pass them right away. What makes these objects different is that they will visually inflate once a time threshold is reached. We should define a timestamp with the creation time of the object. Its lifetime will be a random number between these values. We will use the exploding boolean to tell if the particle should inflate or not. Then we set an initial and a maximum size. Lastly, let's add the speed of inflation. Before we continue with the implementation of methods, let's see if this new class is functional. As it should be. For this, I simply copy-paste the spawning function and modify it a bit. We want to spawn exploding particles. We can set new colors and a new direction. You can play around with these values, it's up to you, I did the same. If you're set, we can add the controls. With the getPressed function, we see if a mouse button is pressed. The left button is the first item, we use this for the default particles. The right button is the third item, let's assign this to the exploding particles. If you followed along, you should see similar results. Let's work on the explosion now. For this, we create a timer method. We get the current time the same way we used when creating this object. Their difference will be the elapsed time. If this is more than the lifetime of the particle, we should set the exploding bool to true. To save computing power, let's check this only if not exploding. Now, let's create a method that handles the explosion. We increase the size of the sprite the same way we used for other attributes. And to actually redraw the circles onto the surface, we can call the createSurf method of the parent class. We should also override the update method to use the explosion timer and inflate methods. Now, as you can see, nothing happens. Exactly. Because the size in the createSurf method is still static, but that's easy to change. Let's add the size attribute to the parent class too, and use that one instead of a static 4, so it can be overwritten later. Before you start your application, take a look why you shouldn't. See? First, we need to create another checker function to kill the sprite if its size reaches maximum. You know the drill, right? It's the same pattern. Now if we check what we created, it's almost complete. Let's add the fading functionality when the explosion happens. Although, we don't see anything yet, since the inflation is much faster than the fading. We can increase the fade speed to resolve this. Now, it looks really nice. Congratulations if you made it so far. There's only one thing left now, and it's pretty simple. I want my mouse to leave floating particles wherever it is. So let's create our last class for today. This will be the floating particle. You can copy-paste this part from the init of exploding particle. Instead of spawning these particles manually, we can use a custom event for this. Thankfully, it's built-in, so it's easy to use. If we have the event, we can set a timer to it. Let's go with 10 milliseconds. We can expand the event part in our main loop. So if the event is equals with the timer we created, we do something. That something is our last function. Again, go ahead and copy-paste. If you try it this way, you get this sparkling effect. But let's just modify the function a bit. I want to spawn the particles from a box around the mouse position. For color, I'll go with white. And I also want it to go upwards only. I limit its speed to 100, and we are set. Let's see the final result. I hope that in your Pygame window you see the same results as I do in mine. Let this be the celebration for the ones who stayed this long during the video. You can also find the complete code I made in the description. Thank you very much for joining, let me know if you have any questions in the comments. Please leave a like if you found this video helpful, and subscribe for more content. See you soon, stay safe, and take care!